Friends, we have a very interesting and a very young and a dynamic entrepreneur today. He is a very successful politician also. At a very young age, he is a member of parliament from Kolhapur. Mr. Dhananjay Mahadik, I would like to request him to come on stage. He is into almost 14 to 15 businesses, one of the largest families in Kolhapur. Started at a very, very young age, and he has been awarded as the second best parliamentarian in the country. So that's quite an achievement. A very visionary young gentleman. When I was going through his details, I felt so good that this country is really progressing in the right direction. When we have young leaders like Mr. Dhananjay Mahadik, I'm sure there is going to be a lot of positive change. What we are going to discuss is his journey as an entrepreneur. Very interesting journey, variety of business models, different strategies, different business models, different investment models. We will go through that as we discuss. 1995, he lost his father, only son for the family. And when father expired, he was in a minor situation financially. From there, today he runs an empire which has got petrol pumps, engineering colleges, schools, bachat ghats, construction, sugar factories. He employs only 3,440 people. He has 495 branches. He has a personal group of 49,500 people across Kolhapur. He's also into the media and entertainment zones. They have got their own music channels. They have got their own television channels. They have got their own news channels. So they cover Kolhapur, Sangli, Satara, Solapur. And they are the largest connectors for entertainment channels in Western Maharashtra. I think they are the largest, covering 15 lakh homes multiplied by 5. So 75 lakh people are in communication with them on a direct basis. So age is just a number. He's very young. There is a long way to go. What we would like to understand to begin with that setback, when you are minus, what was the vision in front of you? How could you get on to build such a large empire?
Actually, good evening, everybody. I will start when my father was alive. So he was my guru, he was my mentor, he was my teacher. As I told, I lost him at a very early age. But when I was in 10th, my father, as I told you, he was a great wrestler. After my 10th, my father and mother had a fight that to which branch should I go. My mother was saying he should go to commerce, and my father was saying he should go to arts. We didn't have any say, so wherever they say, I had to go. Both of them, they won. I asked my mother, why you want me to go to commerce? She said, my maternal uncle, my mama, he was working as a clerk in some bank. So she said, if you get commerce, if you graduate in commerce, you will get a clerical job somewhere. And I asked, why my father wants me to go to arts? So she said, ki he wants to you to go to arts because you don't have to go to the college. You can bunk the college and you go to the akhada and do practice. So ultimately, both of them, they won. I went to commerce, and my father told not to go to college. And this was the journey we started. So actually, it takes five years to graduate. I took 8 years, and this was how my education was. As you told, after my father's loss, I was shattered. Because I belong to a very small family. He was a farmer. We had some agricultural land and few petrol pumps. And I didn't know anything about the pumps and agriculture as well. So we were in a little bit debt. So I was worried because I didn't know anything. My education was not that good. How I should come out of it? And so I started, I thought I should improve the business, because I see a lot of people, they say dream big. To tell you the truth, I have never dreamt anything, because I never believe.
You kept your eyes open and you kept doing it.
I never believed in destiny. I believe in hard work. So this is the rule I follow, that destiny always favors the brave. So this is how I started, and I had the agriculture land and petrol pumps. So we there were a lot of petrol pumps throughout the country. I thought I should do something different so that I can get a good sale. And I went to the transporters, to Gujarat, to Kerala, to Chennai, and we went to them and we told them that we'll get you these facilities. The drivers, they don't bath for 2-3 days, we'll give them free soap, we'll give them food, we'll give them restrooms. And this is how we started, and my pump, it was rated amongst top 10 in India. I got such good sales. So this is how the business came into me. And
in fact, one smart strategy that he adopted was, if there is an accident in 100 kilometers around his pump, all the services to the accident victim, he used to be giving it free of cost. So that also gave him popularity.
This is how we attracted the transporters towards us.
And
I got the sale.
And that helped the business to grow.
Yes,
and their turnover became one of the top 10 in the country.
Yes.
Mr. Mahadik, Kolhapur is considered as one of the richest places in Maharashtra. I think the highest number of BMWs and Mercedes are bought in Kolhapur. Range Rovers as well. So agriculturally, it's a very rich place.
Yes.
And I'm sure the business, the people over there believe in prosperity. They are prospering. It has got good land. So the agriculture is also very powerful. When you started your business there, what were your initial challenges to growth?
As you mentioned, Kolhapur is number 2 in India per capita income growth.
Wow, number what two. Is number 1?
Ludhiana is number 1.
Oh.
It is a very prosperous district. A lot of good land, waters, sun, everything is good, and people are very rich, very rich culture. My entire businesses are around Kolhapur. So, as I mentioned, you do business to earn. If the motive is not there, you cannot do business. So after few 2 years after this my father's death, I planned to diversify, and I was not a technical person. I didn't knew anything. So I thought construction mein thoda jayenge, kuch koshish karenge. So I had a friend, Abhijit, and he was an engineer. So we both sat and we discussed, and we thought we'll try something. So first land we took, it was a very small land, 20,000 square feet. And it was very difficult for us to get the land because we didn't know anything. There were a lot of bargains and a lot of things. But we did that scheme within 8-9 months. And it was a huge success. We earned a lot from that scheme. And thus the construction...
The multiplication began.
Multiplication began.
How much did your boxing and your wrestling background help you in business?
As I told you, I believe in a quote, destiny always favors the brave. So in business...
Your sports gave you bravery in business?
Yes, obviously. You have to have that attitude, you have to have that gut feeling to do any business. This is what I feel.
And also the guts to do it.
Yes.
And
I entered the cable business like this only because for cable business you need a lot of power. Manpower, muscle power, everything. And cable industry was not organized at that time in 2000.
So you're typically in those businesses where you yourself are a strong guy because of
every business you need, but yes, you can say. So we started from Kolhapur and then we expanded.
You have developed a fantastic network of youth in Kolhapur. Like there is a Dhananjay Mahadik Yuva Shakti.
Yes.
Club, that's a group
NGO.
In which NGO where we have enrolled more than 50,000 people.
70,000.
70,000 now.
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. 495 branches,
yes.
80 in the making,
more
I think.
More than 600.
Now more than 600.
Yes.
Fantastic. More than 600 branches. So when you were putting up this network, was it from a political angle or was it from the expansion of business angle or was it?
It was never a political angle. It was just a social purpose. I just wanted to gather the youth and do some good deed and make them do some good deed. It was our agenda that you should not drink, you should not smoke, you should help the poor, needy, widows, and this is how we started. And we started on a very small scale and it grew up because when we started doing good things, families used to come to us, they used to get their son, daughter to us and they used to tell us, ki, enroll him in your organization, let him do something. So we used to give them some work, go help, we used to give, we adopt a village go help people, get students, get small.
And how many years back did this happen? Because you got into politics very recently. How many years back
did this happen? It was like 2003, 2004. That time we started this organization. It was non-political.
So you have a team of people whom you consider as a senior management in your organization who reports to you. How does your hierarchy work?
We have the branches, we have their heads, we have the taluka heads. So this is how we work.
How do you shortlist the key people in your team?
The one who does the best is the person head of that organization over there.
Okay, and how do you monitor that? How do you make them accountable?
No, we organize a meeting every 10-15 days. So the head person, they come to us and they report us. And we give them program what has to be done.
You are almost in 14 to 15 businesses. So I think there was a time, period of time in your life where every alternate year you started a new venture.
Every alternate year, yes.
Every alternate year, yeah.
Since I entered politics,
it is stopped.
That has stopped, yes.
But when you start a business, what is the groundwork that you do, whether you want to get into that business model or not? Like for example, a sugar factory. When you talk about a sugar factory, there is a lot of coordination which happens with the government. So was it a motivator, a demotivator, or what was it?
I never thought about that. I feel when you start a business, you need to have a vision. Is this business going to last? Is this going to run? How many years? What is the future? Other than that, you cannot start it. Because if you don't see the future of that business, see, there are a lot of people who come to us and they show us the pictures, their laptops and all. But until and unless it clicks you, you cannot go into that. So this is how I entered into multiple businesses, that the ideas, the future I saw every business, and when I see it, then only I entered into that business.
For example, when you got into the sugar industry, Maharashtra is known for sugar industry.
Yes.
Western Maharashtra is definitely more powerful in the sugar industry. So when you got into the sugar industry, what was your risk analysis?
Hey, see, sugar industry, we have in India only two, UP and Maharashtra are the sugarcane growers. And my uncle, my father, they were into sugar business before. So I thought ki this is a good business. It has, you can have growth in this business. And that's why I entered into sugar business. And I have a huge sugar industry in Solapur district.
How do you train your manpower? Because with so many businesses, various lines of activities, how do you get them trained locally?
I have different kind of people in all different sectors, because you cannot place a sugar person in college. So in engineering college, we have MBA college, we have some schools, we have some kindergarten schools, we have an agriculture college. So basically, we need people who are known to that business or who are dedicated to that business. So we don't mix up. So this is how we choose the people.
How do you do the finance management of your organization? Because a growing organization will always want funds at a very regular interval.
Yes, every day before I start my office, I give an hour to all my businesses. I get reports from each and every business. I go through it and I speak with the concerned heads. And after that, I start my business, because I have to meet every day 2,000, 3,000 people every day they come to my office. So before starting this political office, I start business and I speak with them, and whatever is needed, that has been done.
Is it beneficial to be a politician to do business in India?
I don't think so. In some cases, yes, if you have to run a toll, you need to be a politician. So not in every sector, I could say.
Now your time is divided between business and politics. How do you balance it?
That's a bit difficult, because you in politics you have to give your 100%. You cannot give your time, more time to the business. So that's what I said. Because of entering into politics, I am a bit diversified towards my business. But my wife, she's my biggest strength, and she's a good support. So she handles everything, and I hope my sons, they are likely to come within a year or two. So they'll be handling the business.
When you're growing your businesses in a place like, in a beautiful city like Kolhapur, small town or city that you can call it, how did you face competition? How did you handle it? And how did you take advantage from your competition?
Competition, there is competition in every business. But what has happened is, because of these multiple ventures, we have come to a very good goodwill. So my name is a brand. So as I told you, when construction site we start, the day of the Bhumi Pujan, we get 50% booking done. So this is how the goodwill.
You know, they are sure the project will complete.
They are sure the project is good. We are giving good amenities. I told you that in every business, you have, see, there are a lot of people who are doing the same business. What can you do? What value addition can you? In cable, I could say, before government launched cash system, we did it. 2 years before, we bought set-top boxes from China and we distributed. Before Mumbai bought the set-top boxes. Before Mumbai started HD channels, we started in Kolhapur. So this is what we saw, the vision, and now we are in monopoly business. So every business you have to think differently and act differently.
So you stay ahead by taking quick decisions, that's
yes,
one. And
yes,
you stay ahead because you bring technology irrespective of the scope, the quantum of investment.
Yes.
You ensure that you're ahead of the competition by being the first mover.
Yes, you have to be the first, then only you can survive.
Fantastic. Whenever you start a business, there is an existing market for that with existing players. How do you increase your market share?
That's what I said.
Like for example, we can take the example of your construction business. When you began in Kolhapur, there were already existing players.
There are
what is the difference that you did from the others?
There are hundreds of
developers.
Developers in Kolhapur. But that's what I said. You need to have a pilot project. So when first site we made, people while doing the booking, they wish to see what they have done before. So we have done such a beautiful scheme. One of our scheme is rated India's number one scheme in Kolhapur. It has having 98 flats, I guess. And after the survey, it was rated top in India.
On what grounds?
All the specifications, the amenities we give, the quality of work, the electrification, the drain system, the sewage system, everything. It is like an ISO. So this is what we do in Kolhapur. So after seeing this scheme, people are attracted towards us.
So in short, you're a man of quality who will invest in quality output.
Yes.
So that the customer is happy.
Yes. Surely even in cable industry, we believe in service. See, anybody can come into this industry. But even, you know, Dish TV, everything is, the advertisements are going. But in Kolhapur, Dish TV sale is not so good. Because when people go to the shop and they ask for Dish TV, they ask, do we see B channel or B news on this? Our channel and our news, she looks after it. So when the shop owner says, you cannot see this on the dish, they don't take the dish, they take our connection. So this is what we have made out of our network.
Superb, superb, superb. When you started your educational institutions, what was your ambition in that? And is it beneficial to have schools or colleges or both?
Schools, so I started quite before, but while starting the engineering college, Kolhapur is a very small place. There were very few engineering colleges, and people, young guys, they could not get admission in the colleges. They have to pay whatever. So I decided that I should get a college where no donation, we have put a board on that, no donations here. And that's how we started, and I wanted to start, but it was a huge investment. And we started this engineering, MBA, and related faculties over there. And it was a good success. I got all students who have never dreamt of going to an engineering college. Such kind of students are in my college.
So they became engineers, and I'm sure you must
yes.
be helping in them getting jobs
yes,
also.
We are organizing camps for them. Big companies, they come to, we have campus interviews. And I assure that all the students who are passed out from my college, they get jobs.
Any business model which is government dependent and dependent on suppliers who are farmers are in very, very dicey shape in this country. I'm talking about the sugar industry. A lot of sugar industries go sick very fast. Lots of people make that happen intentionally also. So how is your sugar industry management different from the other sugar industry manufacturers in the country?
No, basically, any agriculture product, it's dependent on the nature. So last 2-3 years, we had a very bad drought in India. And because of this, all the sugar factories are facing a lot of problem. Even my factory was in some problem, but not that much like others. But we are in a good shape. The market on which the sugar prices are dependent, it is in the hands of government. So government controls the sugar prices. But we have to give FRP. It is called FRP, you must be knowing. So this is the minimum price to be given to the farmers, okay. the sugarcane growers. So that is fixed. So suppose the FRP is 2800 and the sugar price is 3000. There is only 200 rupees margin. So you cannot give 2800 FRP, but it is mandatory. You cannot sell above 3000. So you get a loss of like production cost loss is like 700-800 rupees. So this is how
So what is your reason to be in such a business model?
No, this is what it's happened in these 2 years.
Otherwise it
is a good business. I want to expand in sugar industry. Some more sugar factories I want to put now.
You are also into the agro business. India is a land of agriculturalists.
Yes.
And you are also into agro business. What is the business model that you follow in the agri industry?
I have sugarcane, pomegranate, lime, lemon, and wheat, rice.
What innovation have you done in that?
We have made all our land with the drip irrigation. It's like
the Israel technology.
No man required. This is how we have made it, and we are following few, like it is computerized. The fertilizers we give, that is computerized. It gives a chart. It's like everything is programmed, and so you get good yield. And when you have good yield and good quality product, you don't need to go to the market. The market people will come to your place and they'll buy your products. This is how we do it.
So you feel agro industry is a good future for getting into for businessmen?
Agriculture is the best industry for India, I should say, because last few years you see every country in the world is facing recession. India didn't face that much because of agriculture. This is what I feel.
No, you must be right. He's also on the board of the Commerce Ministry of India. He's also on the board, one more board. You're on the board of?
Urban Development.
So I'm sure now the knowledge that he gets on the front of governments also might be helping you to take business decisions. How informed is your business decision? Have you closed any business that you have started?
No, not exactly it will help my business, but it will help
sector.
The country.
The sector.
The jute industry, coir industry, or coconut, palm. This is what our commerce is related to.
So, did you close any business after you started that? Because you have started so many businesses.
Only the restaurant.
You closed it?
Yes.
And what was the reason for that?
Because it needs a lot of attention. The one who looks after it, he has to stay there till 2 o'clock at night. And again, he'll have to start at 6 in the morning. And there is a lot of labor problem in this industry. The moment any other new restaurant starts in the city, there is a reshuffling. So I didn't find it quite good. And basically, it is a service and, you know, taste. Ek bhi din gadbad ho jaye to problem ho jata hai, toh I didn't like that much, so I just closed it.
You have a very robust HR system since you have more than 3,500 people working for you.
Yes.
You have a robust HR system.
Yes.
Couple of my friends here are also into agriculture. They like to do agriculture. The challenge that they face is, these days you don't get people to work in the fields. So when you do agriculture on more than 500 acres of land, how do you manage that?
That's how you have to do all the modernizations. See, when you visit Australia, you can see one family, one husband and wife, they manage 500 cows. They manage 2,000 acres of land, only one family. But we don't follow that. We need hundreds of workers to do a certain work. So we have to upgrade ourselves and we have to do modernization in our farms.
You are also into the dairy industry, connected to the dairy industry,
yes.
Gokul, Doodh and
yes.
other allied industries.
Yeah, even I have 70 cows and buffaloes.
So Gokul is one of the largest, I think, milk producers of the country.
Asia's number three.
Amul is one.
Amul is number one. Mother's Dairy is there, and Gokul is number three.
So you all are actively operative in that.
It is a cooperative industry basically, and our collection of milk is daily.
Can you explain to my friends on how a cooperative sector works? Because cooperative sector is very popular in the state of Maharashtra. I don't think so. It's everywhere.
Maharashtra, Kerala,
Gujarat,
yes. Only two, three states.
Yeah. So how does the business model in the cooperative sector operate?
Sugar or milk?
Any, sugar and milk, both.
First, I'll explain sugar. Sugar, we like my sugar factory, we are having 21,000 members. They need to have a certain land, like 20 guntas to be the member of the factory, to the society. It is mandatory for them to cultivate sugarcane and supply to the factory within 5 years of span. If there is drought situation, it is exception. But otherwise, they have to supply. And this is how you get the raw material. See, sugar industry, to run a sugar industry, you need sugarcane. And we are having ample of sugarcane. So we have excess sugarcane. So what we did, we thought of going to byproducts. Like we went into cogeneration. The bagasse we used to sell, now we produce electricity from that. Then from the molasses we manufacture, we can make RNC, like it goes to the alcohol or the factories. So this is how the bioproducts work. And the members who are attached to us, we give priority to the members to take their sugar cane and we pay them. In milk, it is similar. We are having like 3,000 societies, not the milk producers. Each society is having like 200 milk producers. Like one female, she is having one cow or two cow or one buffalo. So she gets the milk every day morning and evening to the society in that village. And we collect from that village and we get it to our factory. It's in situation in Kolhapur. And thus we get 12 lakh liters every day. And we process it, we make it into small pouches and we deliver it to Mumbai, Pune and all over Maharashtra, Nasik, everywhere. This is how it works and we pay them every 10 days. So milk payment is done every 10 days. Sugarcane payment is done after every 15 days. This is how it works.
Fantastic. What is going to be your next business venture?
I should not disclose, but I want to enter into food and fruit processing business because it has a very good prospects abroad. As you can see, in US, UK, Europe, anywhere, they import everything. They don't produce much of this agriculture products, especially grapes, pomegranate, any vegetables. So it has a good prospectus, I feel. And I've visited a few units abroad and here, and I'm thinking when my son will come back, I'll go into that business.
Fantastic. So friends, that is Mr. Mahadik for you. And we can all start interacting and asking questions to him. Yes, Sidhu.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
My question to you is, when you start a new venture, how do you ensure that your focus over the previous venture is not lost and equal time or maybe...
You need to have good people in each of your venture, because I keep myself very busy. I'm always very busy because of this politics as well. So you need to have good people. So I have a very good group of my friends who are very trustworthy. And I have placed one friend in one sector or in one venture. So I can trust him fully. And he will act there as Dhananjay Mahadik. I have given him those rights. And in every business, you need to have the returns. You should look after the returns. So whatever you are investing, you should know every month I have to get this or every year I have to get this. You just have to focus on that.
So you delegate only responsibility or also the power?
Both. But the decisions, they are lying with me.
Then you are delegating only the responsibility.
Yes, some decisions they can take. Some decisions they have to...
Yes.
You being from a business background, what made you enter into politics, and was entering into politics profitable for your business?
I cannot say it is profitable for business, but me entering into politics it was an accident. So I didn't wanted to get into this field, but unfortunately or fortunately, you can say, it was a situation where there was a stalwart member of parliament from Kolhapur. He was there for 25 years. And he was very strong. Nobody could have defeated him. So people who were opposite of his group, they came to me and they said, you have to contest. I said, I'm not interested. And I had a very good background. I had a clean image. My organization was so large. That's why they came to me. And then I can spend. So all this mattered. And This is how I entered into politics. But first election, I lost. That time I was
with a very thin margin of 13,000 votes.
11,700.
Out of 4 lakh votes, he just lost.
I got 3,89,000 and he got 4 lakh votes. So this is how I lost. And that time I realized why people had voted me. They expect something from me. And I should not go away from this. And this is how I entered politics.
So did that?
But I cannot say this is helping my business in any way.
That's a political answer.
No.
Yeah.
But what I would like to ask you is, when you lost, I'm sure you must have come with more force
the next day morning, 8 o'clock, I was in my office.
Working again for the goal.
I was planning for the next election.
Superb. Everybody knows why Donald Trump became the president of United States. He got insulted by Obama.
Yes.
So we should all look out for opportunities where we can get insulted. We can in fact send messages to people, please insult us. That might be leap in our life.
That loss went into my head.
That is the only time you must have ever lost in your life.
Yes.
Probably
I have lost couple of times even while wrestling. See, this is how I learned. So not to get embarrassed or upset when you lost. When you lose.
But come back with force, power.
Yes.
Not to give up.
Many times this has happened. To the person I have lost in the field, in boxing or wrestling, the next time I make sure I defeated him.
Oh.
Like Dangal, you must have seen it.
Yes.
It relates to my family.
Being on the member of these governing bodies of commerce, as the CMD pointed out, have we ever as a government tried to see that the entrepreneurs, say maybe this gathering or otherwise, are very much a part of the system for bid for government projects or government stores or government procurement thing? We don't see that. Myself had been involved with global procurement in that, and even the government defense procurement. But we never saw Indian entrepreneurs as mundane as for general items as well in larger numbers. The reason behind I just want to put across is this L1 tendency, lowest quote. There should be something done, since you're at the governing bodies, to take up this issue that lowest quote thing has to be done away with in terms of quality beckons. That is not allowed. And that's the reason why we don't get quality things in the government or otherwise. There's a huge chunk of business. It's literally $1 trillion worth of business.
I agree with you. You can give your suggestions. I'll make sure that I can put forth it. But what I could say is, it is vice versa. When the government takes initiative, people don't want to join it. This is the other side of the coin.
Abhijit, now he is with the government, not an entrepreneur. So he will protect the government.
I have been traveling through this committee to various places, India and abroad. I have seen very less participation of entrepreneurs.
It is lack of awareness.
So even government people, they think they are least interested. Why? See, they will make an announcement that you can join. But if there is no response, they will not make any effort.
Since you have such a large group of youths, so how many of them actually you are helping them to get into the entrepreneurship? Because Maharashtrian community, I belong to that. So it is considered to be the underdogs in terms of the business community. This is the question one. And what do you foresee the kind of environment that we have in the country today? So is it conducive for entrepreneurs and business to grow? Is it going to improve?
Definitely.
Yeah.
For my youth organization, we organize a lot of camps for the youth because we are attached with the people who are from a very small villages. And they are basically farmers or they are workers. So we, as a business model, we teach them. There are a lot of things, but I'll name a few. We try and teach them how to make goat farming or goat farming project. We try and give them finance from NABARD. There are government schemes going around. So a group of youth from a city, from a village, they can come together and do one business. And there are too many businesses are there, small businesses, which they can come for women from their households. She trains them and we try them to get into small businesses. They cannot grow like what you people are, but still we are trying.
So there are a lot of initiatives that he has taken.
Lot of
his wife is also handling for Mahila Bachat Ghat,
for
youngsters.
If I start telling, it will take whole night because we are doing lot of things.
So I am involved in an organization called Saturday Club where we actually foster entrepreneurship across the Maharashtra state.
Kolhapur, I think you should get associated with Bhima Business Group.
We have a chapter there. My second question to you is looking at the situation currently.
Right now the situation in India, I don't know how everybody sees it, but I see why I came into construction, why I came into this business, because India is a growing country. Even being an opposition of BJP, I am from NCP, I would say Modi ji has taken India to a different height globally. And there are lot of things coming up, like infrastructure development is going to be huge in India because a lot of money is being invested right now with the government or with the banks. So when infrastructure is growing, related things also grow together. Like you need good engineers, good suppliers. So this is how entrepreneurs will. They will need entrepreneurs. They cannot take a small labor for as an engineer. You can understand that.
Thank you.
Yes.
Sir, today you may be in a position where you are not only funding your projects, but maybe a lot of other projects of other entrepreneurs as well. But few years back when you just started post your father's death and started getting into entrepreneurship, then what was your source of funds? Because you grew so fast in so less number of years. So was bank finance the only thing, or?
Bank was there, profits were there from my business, from agriculture. This is how I made up.
And agriculture is tax free.
Agriculture and petrol pump, I was having only two sources. And few banks, first they denied because they think ye wapas nahi karega. It was like that.
It's a common rule. People don't give, banks don't give loans to people who need money. They give loans to people who have money.
So what I did when they deny, I put an X amount in the bank as a deposit. Then they realize that he can give it back.
Yes, Mr. Matthias. Oh, Sunny.
Yeah, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
You happen to be on the Committee of Urban Development, and they just announced that they would be constructing around 1.5 crore houses in urban areas, around 4.5 crore houses in rural areas. So looking at the quantum and the volume, and they want to deliver it in next 6 years. So doing it conventionally, it is next to a difficult, impossible thing. So what initiatives has been taken from
government? They are not doing it conventionally. They have launched a new scheme. It is for the people who don't own their, who don't own a house or don't own a land. So there, it is like 9 lakhs and 12 lakh rupees. You are talking about the same thing,
I guess.
So what is the model behind it is, like a person like me who is having a big land, I can accommodate 100 families. So out of 100 families, every family will, they will get 9 lakh rupees. So this is how the model is going to work. Because a poor person, he doesn't have a land also. So buying a land and constructing a house is way far. So this is the model that big persons should come involved in this. Big lands are required, and then only they can accommodate these people.
Okay, when it comes to, when you say you are not going it conventionally, so have you identified any technologies specifically?
The surveys have been already done. That to who owns a house, who, you must be knowing ration card, Aadhaar card. So everything is marked out.
People, no, he is asking, are you shortlisted the vendors who can do the job?
Yes, that's what I am saying. The job.
The job.
No. It is open for all. Even I am thinking to make a project out of it.
And he is also asking the question because he is also thinking to do that. There is a Prime Minister's Yojana of constructing 6,000 or 8,000, 4,000 Anganwadis across India. He has got the contract for 2,000 Anganwadis. He has already executed how many? 100. So the model is Vedanta pays for the Anganwadi.
So you already know it, how it works.
So he wanted to know whether his name is there in the vendor list.
He wanted to know. He wanted to know.
His name
is going
there.
To work.
Yeah, he's a smart cookie.
I'll be there for the cement.
Yes, Makran.
Good evening.
Good evening.
You just mentioned that in sugar you have 21,000 farmers as your shareholders.
And in one sugar factory.
And in milk also you have several societies as your shareholders.
Yes.
In other ventures, any plan to come out with an IPO?
I don't think right now. But for this, what I was speaking about earlier, for the food and fruit industry processing unit, I might go for cooperative only because there is a huge investment, like 500 crores. So that time I have to think, I guess.
And you don't need a IPO for a cooperative activity. Government supports big time. Yes.
Yeah, you are there in the government committee on that agriculture, and you said that the future growth of the country will be...
I'm not on the committee of agriculture, but no. I am an agriculturist, I'm a farmer.
Achha, okay. And the future growth of this country will be driven also by the agriculture.
Yes.
So, but we are all from south, so we have a lot of coconut plantations. And today the fate of those farmers are so bad that they don't even pluck the coconuts. They have to allow them to fall because that will cost them more. You have a minimum wages for paddy, you have minimum wages for minimum price for your rubber. Why nothing is being done for the coconut?
See, just drinking a coconut will not solve this problem. They'll have to, as I said, you have to go for the value addition. Coconut and sugarcane, both products are such products that you can use every single millimeter of that product. Right. Even in sugarcane, the sugar, when the sugar is crushed, the bagasse is used for
paper,
electricity, the molasses is used for alcohol, RNS. Similarly, sugar in coconut, it's like that. You can make coir, you can make
oil.
Coconut oil, coconut milk, you can burn the coconut shell. So you have to do value addition. When you visit abroad, you see, you get a container of coconut water for 150 rupees. Where you get a coconut here in 5 rupees. So this is how the farmer has to they get together and do something like this.
You had one more angle to your question. Some minimum wages you are talking
about.
Yeah,
I was asking why no minimum rate has been fixed, just like any other
industry.
Like you have a minimum wages for, minimum rate for your
right,
sugar.
MRP,
sugar.
MRP.
Yeah.
Only sugarcane is having that MRP.
Because coconut is grown only in Kerala, not in Maharashtra. Wheat also you have.
No. Only for sugarcane and cotton, we have this minimum wages.
Rubber
is not an agricultural produce, but after making a rubber, it has. Other vegetables and fruits, they don't have any MRP. Or FRP. So this is what we are fighting since long with the government, that there has to be a limit.
Sushant.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I have a question to you. Practically, you are handling 15 businesses in a period of 1 to 2 hours on a daily basis. So what kind of a reporting system do you follow, and what kind of a dashboard do come to you early in the morning, and how do you prioritize and take action on the problems that you have on hand?
See, I have all my businesses are really set businesses. I have to look after few. My wife looks after few. As I told, early in the morning when I reach my office, all my managers are there with the report. So I just go through it and discuss with them if they have any problem. Usually, there is no problem in petrol pumps, in construction. Everything is routinized. Only in cable industry we face some swapping or something like that. So that time we give decision that you can do this. If they have taken your 10 boxes, you take his 20 boxes back. So this is this is what you have to just tell them. In sugar industry, it's routine. It's only a 4-5 months business. So now is the off season. So only when the crushing is going on, you need to pay more attention to the business.
So do you take care only of the financial decisions majorly, or you also get into the operational part of it?
No, only financial. Operation, everything is set up and they look after
so
it.
So you have delegated it to people who are
experts in that particular
land. Last two questions. Yeah, Mr. Sikwara.
Yeah. My question is about the construction industry. Recently, government has brought an act, wherein there are restrictions on the builders while accepting the money of those flat buyers or this one, because there are so many. So how is going to affect the working capital of the builders?
The RERA, you are talking about RERA.
Yeah.
We are opposing it. I am on the state side where you are. We are hopeful that it will change, but right now it's a bit difficult to manage, you cannot use the funds from one side to another side, and it's very difficult for a company to run. So we are putting some pressure to the government.
Last question. Yeah, Glenn.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
My question to you was, your empire spans over 14 businesses, which is a huge amount of diversification. So what was the thought process while going from one business to the other? Was it that you were in one business and that was able to connect to the other, so you were able to go from one business to the other and to the other? Or was it just you saw an opportunity?
It's only money. See, any business you can face recessions. Every business you can face recessions. So this is how when I started, there was a period when petrol pumps were having recession as well, because the state governments, Maharashtra and Karnataka, they had different policies about taxes, and our rate from Maharashtra were more than Karnataka, and Kolhapur is at the border of Karnataka. So all our sale, it went to Karnataka, and we were trying with the government, but we could not do anything for one and a half year. That time I realized that I should diversify. So this is how it came into mind, and as I told you, you need to be visionary. When I went into cable industry, it was unorganized sector, and I thought that we should make it corporate, and this is how we entered the cable business. Then we went into malls, like one of my partner, he was having a mall somewhere else, so I brought him to Kolhapur and we constructed a mall, and it is the biggest mall in Western Maharashtra, clothing. So this is how it was, like multiple business. I have gas agencies, oil agencies, transport we need for petrol pumps. So this
is when you're cash positive, every business starts coming your way and you keep on expanding. Yeah, Shubhangi.
We are talking about women empowerment and we are talking it for decades. So, but the effect is not seen. But you have set an
effect is not seen.
Not to that extent.
I don't agree.
No, still we are talking about it. Now is the time we should have been equal. But you have set up a good example. You have given full majority of the things you have given it. So do you give her decisions? Are they
final decisions?
Final decisions?
I never oppose her decision. I can't.
Okay.
Is that the truth? The camera is on him, not
no,
on you.
No, touch wood, I would say she's better than me in business, because sometimes I'm a bit lenient about expenses and she said no. This is how it works.
Finance minister.
Yes.
Right. Thank you.
And she, I could name few businesses, because when she was not looking after it and when she started looking after it, it has grown many folds.
Fantastic. Yes, Nago.
How's your thought process till now in terms of expanding and adding businesses? And how is it going to be moving forward? Do you feel that you're in a secured position and you need to take more calculated risks, or would you still give it the same shot?
See, every business you need to take risk, any business you start. As I told you, I was quite fortunate. I followed the rules of my father, and that's how I started my businesses, and I took bold steps. I contributed, I did hard work. As I told you, we went to Kerala, Andhra. When we started in cable business, we went to houses to get to please get connected. This is how we started. So it was hard work, and I believe when you do hard work, there is no shortcut for being successful. When you start any venture, you have to be successful, and I believe hard work pays. This is how each of my businesses started and doing good, and only the restaurant I told, and I'm quite sure I can do many more businesses, just because I'm stuck up in this member of parliamentarianship, and I have to work very hard for this also, because I have to study a lot, I have to do a lot of homework, I have to read a lot, and books, novels, newspapers, TV channels, news. And because of this, I am not able to concentrate on my new ventures or new business. But I am quite sure my children, my son, when they'll come back, they're having the business genes in them. So they will, and I have instructed them many times. They have to start their own business. They don't have to look after my business. They should start new ventures. I'll help them. And they have to be on their own. And this is how I have explained them.
That is another indirect way of expansion. Yeah. Here, anyway, or leke aao. So I think that's a good milestone for the children as well. We would like to thank Mr. Dhananjay Mahadik. That was a brilliant interaction. Thanks for sharing very open-heartedly. I would like to request Vishnu to please come up. Friends, Vishnu's company, Auro Labs, which has changed rules in the eye care industry world over, has completed 25 years. In between, the Google co-owner, I forget his name, Larry Page, flew in his private aircraft to see their facility in Madurai. So anybody traveling to Madurai should see two things, our project and Auro Labs. And of course, the famous Meenakshi Madurai temple.